So last night was the first time that I got to meet John Nowatzki. He's from North Dakota State University. I talked to him last year. We almost had him come out last year, but I got a hold of him at the last minute. He said, I'll tell you what, I'll come out next year for you. And he sure did. And I had a real interesting conversation with him last night over dinner. We had some crabs over at the crab deck. And so I'm going to turn it over to him, something that I know everyone's real interested in. And don't call it a drone. It's not a drone. It's a UAS. So
thank you very much. Get this down here a little bit. Well, I appreciate the opportunity to share a lot. I've been spending an awful lot of my time the last 6 months working with unmanned aircraft. In fact, it's pretty much consumed all of my time. I am an ag machinery specialist. I'm 100% extension, so I do the same thing the other folks here do. I do a lot of work with, most of my work over the last 10, 15 years has been on precision ag technology. However, now this year, I'm really focusing on this project. I have a couple other projects just to give you a little bit of idea. We're doing a soil compaction project in corn because farmers are seeing the different row, the height of plants next to the rows, next to the wheel tracks, and they're wondering what, you know, the real impact is. So we're doing hand harvesting on that. We're doing a project with using imagery, close-up imagery, to look at iron chlorosis deficiency in soybeans. We're also doing a project with optical sensors. I guess most people call the whole technology green seeker technology, but we're doing a project with that on different nitrogen rates as well. But anyway, we've been doing an awful lot with unmanned aircraft, and one of the things just occurred to me when Joe was speaking. I'm working with one farm, working with a lot of farmers. I'm working with a farmer that is planted two different hybrid varieties of soybeans, only row-by-row difference across the field. And he set up his planter to do that. And he's looking at issues with iron chlorosis deficiency. And I don't know if you have that issue here at all. I guess not. But it's a serious issue. And we're taking real high-resolution aerial imagery and being able to do an NDVI row-by-row. And we're seeing those hybrids that are on a high saline area that are supposed to perform well on a, you know, more of a defensive type variety. We're seeing that difference. We don't have the results yet, but that's just another example of what we can do with this. Usually, you know, I just presented information like this 2 weeks ago in Sacramento at the International Conference on Precision Ag. I'd like to give credit to the other folks that are involved in this. You might not recognize any of them, but then again, maybe some of you will. But we're working with a lot of different people on unmanned aircraft, and what we're doing on both crops and livestock, we're flying all the research that livestock researchers and crop researchers are doing at one of the NDSU, North Dakota State University, research farms similar to this. So we're flying it on a weekly basis. In fact, they are flying today, and they're going to start in 15 minutes. So they fly once a week to gather that data. We're collecting a lot of data. I'm not going to be able to share nearly as much scientific results as I'd like to, because we don't have that, you know, the response, all the data from the field, from the ground researchers. We won't have that until the end of the year. And it'll be available on a website. You can do a search for NDSU and my name, or at the end of the time, I have a website on my last slide that shows where you can get all the scientific data. What I'd like to talk about is all kinds of, the idea of what kind of UAS that might be valuable in agriculture, some of the big issues that are involved, and then specifically what we're doing. But we got started on this because last fall, last winter, early winter, so many of the large companies came to us at the university, and I'm sure it's the same at other universities, Boeing and Northrop Grumman, companies like that, and said, how can we get involved in agriculture? And my message to them has always been the same to start with, that we don't have any research to show what we can do with unmanned aircraft. I remember saying to Boeing, I know that you can make unmanned aircraft, and I know that you can fly them, and I know that you can fly them over Afghanistan, and you can tell whether somebody's carrying a hoe or an AK-47, but can you pick out an aphid on a soybean plant? There's a lot of difference. And so that's what our research is focused on. I'm from North Dakota, and most of you probably know two things about North Dakota. One of them is that there's a movie now called Fargo and a television series also. And if any of you have ever seen that movie, we have a new beer company, one of the microbreweries in Fargo, and the beer that sells the best is called Wood Chipper IPA. Some of you saw the movie. There was a body, and they had to get rid of the body, and they ran it through a wood chipper. Okay. This is a map of North Dakota. Our research is all being done at one site at Carrington at NDSU Research Center. It's about 2 miles from north to south and about a mile from east to west. There are a lot of different research plots in there. And in each one of these, there might be many different types of trials, different kinds of rotations, crop rotations, different kinds of residue trials, herbicide, fungicide, different hybrids, all kinds of research. And so I made very little effort in determining what should be flown. That's done by the researchers. I need to point out that, I was going to say the other thing that you might know about North Dakota is that we have oil. We have lots of oil lately, and as a result of that, we have funds available from the state legislature to do research. They appropriated, in the last session, our legislature meets only every other year, they appropriated $6 million to to do research for the universities. And there's two research universities in North Dakota. One that I'm at, the North Dakota State University in Fargo, and the other one is University of North Dakota in Grand Forks. And all of that $6 million has to be funded through these two research universities. And they have a project, they have a program called Research North Dakota, and that's where we funded this. The unique thing about our legislature, we're a very red state. Every dollar that comes to us from this fund has to be matched dollar for dollar from industry. So if we get $50,000 from this, we have to get $50,000 from industry, which is a good idea, I think. And as a result of that, we funded it from this Research North Dakota, but also a large part by a company called LWS. It's really a surveying company that uses unmanned aircraft in other countries where it's legal to do it commercially to replace RTK surveying. So, for example, they could survey this area, and if you left a pack of cigarettes out here on the middle of the grass, this imagery would pick it up and be able to make a really accurate 3D model. That company is using equipment to do open pit mining. Every day they give, for example, a volumetric, so how many cubic feet have been removed each day. But they wanted to get involved in agriculture, so they came to us. We're also using North Dakota Soybean Funds, North Dakota Corn Council, and it's important to note that North Dakota is one of the six FAA test sites. And that has put some extra restrictions on us instead of making it easier. And I'll point that out. Our objectives, as I said, it's a proof of concept. Our objectives are to use full color red, green, blue cameras, thermal cameras, and near-infrared cameras on all this different research that's going on. And the research, of course, is ongoing research, so we could just tag on to that. We're doing both crop and livestock. I'll show some examples of both. And because these grant funds are coming through the North Dakota Department of Commerce, their prime reason for providing us the money is economic development in North Dakota. So it's very important to recognize that we have to come back with economic models to our granting agency. And I'm an extension specialist, so we'll be developing and are developing a number of publications. One of them is on data management. One is on selecting unmanned aircraft. One's on selecting the sensors. And those will all be available at the end of this calendar year and available for download. But we'll be using that in extension programs. Our outcomes, again, are to validate uses to identify uses for companies, both companies that sell and UAS and producers and consultants that want to use it. We're looking at that business model for all of it. And we want to promote the commercialization of UAS. North Dakota is interested, obviously, in getting anything that would do economic development in the state. There's a lot of studies being out, but one of the studies showed that there was $83 million potential, which doesn't seem like a lot, but for a small state, that's a small population state, that does mean something. And of course, billions and billions across. But most of that prediction is in agriculture. I asked, when I put this together last October and November, I went to the research station and said, what are some of the things that we could fly? What are some of the objectives that we should look at? And this is just a list. Again, difficult to read and not meant for all of it, but we're looking at plant emergence, we're looking at plant populations, nutrient deficiencies, disease symptoms, weed infestations, moisture stress. In particular, we're going to be looking at dry down of corn with imagery, trying to predict where the moisture content is. On animals, we're looking, I guess the ones we're really looking at is breeding activity, temperatures of animals, being able to measure if an animal is in estrus cycle or whether or not an animal has a fever. You know, if we could pick up an animal that has a fever in a feedlot, we'd be able to find out those animals that are getting sick before you could walk through the feedlot and pick those out. We're also looking at counting animals, obviously. This will be the easiest one, but that's important. I used to own cattle, and when I owned the cattle about 30 years ago, a stock cow was worth $350. Now you can almost add a zero to that. Typically, cows are worth $2,000 to $2,500. So if you've got 300 of them out on your range or your pasture, you want to make sure they're there. This is an easy way to do it. The livestock researcher that wanted to look at this, he said, I want to be able to look at different feedlot beddings. So we're using a thermal camera for that. So in other words, if you're using sand or sawdust or corn stover or wheat straw, which one is more comfortable for the cattle in the middle of the summer when it's 95 degrees and a high humidity? Which one is more comfortable for the cattle when it's 25 degrees below zero in the middle of the winter? So we're measuring those temperatures as well. These are the equipment that we're using. One is called a dragon flyer. It's made in Saskatchewan, Canada. It costs about $20,000 with its cameras. And the other one is a Trimble UX5, and that one costs twice that much with its cameras, about $50,000. Now, as I indicated, we are one of those test sites. And so we've got the eyes of FAA on us more, I think, than any of the other states. This project that I'm doing was the first project that was done for research under any of those six test sites. It's the first one, so the FAA folks came out there and took pictures of us, and the governor came, and all those people that were interested. And now they don't come as much anymore, but they're still coming. The point is, we applied for a certificate of authorization from FAA in the end of January to fly, and at that time, this aircraft was put on it. And then in about the 1st of April, we got that one on the middle of we got permission from FAA in the middle of May. In April, we applied for this one, and we still don't have permission to fly that aircraft. We've flown it on some examples, but we don't have permission from FAA to fly that Trimble. So it's taken a long time, and it's a big issue. Let me go back to that. I want to just talk a little bit about who can and who cannot, and what you can do with UAS in the United States. And I know that I work with farmers that are using unmanned aircraft. There's 2 million acres in North Dakota being flown commercially by unmanned aircraft this year that I know of. And farmers, the owners are paying anywhere from $3 or $4 an acre to $15 or $18 an acre for that imagery to be flown. So it's being done commercially. But we can't do that at the university. We have to have permission. Basically, to use unmanned aircraft in the United States, there's two ways to do it legally. And this is open to a lot of discussion, and I welcome comments and questions. But one way is any one of us can do it for fun. And we can do it right here today for fun, any one of us. There are some rules that you have to do it for fun. It's recreational purposes. You can't be any closer than 5 miles to an airport. You have to be under 400 feet. And for those of you who are pilots, you know why that is. Manned aircraft can't fly below 500 feet. You know, there's some exceptions like spray pilots. But so there's that 100-foot. So you have to be 5 miles from an airport, under 400 feet. You have to be within line of sight. You have to be able to see it. And you have, fourthly, you have to be able to control it. You have to be able to interact with it. So that line of sight is an interesting one. When I fly these aircraft, I can't see them. When they get about a half a mile away, I lose sight of them. I was doing a test of the Trimble one, and to do that, Trimble won't sell you this unless you go through their training, 4-day training. And when I was doing my training, the Trimble person was standing beside me. We were out in Wyoming, on the plains of Wyoming in March, I think it was, and I was watching. You know, you have a little computer in front of you. That's where you control it. Then I'd look up to see it. And he said, do you see it? Do you have eye contact? I said, yeah, it's right up there. And he laughed a little bit. And I thought, oh, that's interesting. He said, are you sure you see it? And I said, yeah, it's right there. Can't you see it? And then it flapped its wings. It was a bald eagle. And I confused it. And it was because I was looking up there and looking down, looking up. And it's probably also because, you know, your eyesight deteriorates. Okay. These are the cameras that we're using. We're using a FLIR thermal camera that gives, yes?
You said there was a second way that you could.
Oh, I'm sorry. I should be following notes. I don't have any notes in front of me. The second way that you can do it legally is through a university. So we apply for a COA from FAA, and they then give us permission. It has to be for a specific aircraft. It has to be for a specific geographic location, and it could be 5 counties, it could be the state of Maryland. For us, it was a 2-kilometer radius around that research site. And you have to tell when you're going to fly it. And it doesn't have to be specific dates, but like June, July, and August. And then you have to report data to the FAA, certain kinds of data, like how much battery was left on your aircraft after you flew it for 15 minutes, that kind of stuff. Yes?
So you said that there's over 2 million acres being used in agriculture now, and then you mentioned prices, but I thought the FAA wouldn't let you do this to make money.
Is there anybody here from the FAA? Okay, then we'll answer it. Because I know I'm far enough away that none of my administrators are here. But people are doing it, and they know that the FAA does not have a law, does not have an enforcement arm. So they have nobody out across the United States. Secondly, people understand that safety isn't always an issue, and privacy is an issue. So for those folks that are here that are flying these aircraft, I know that you are primarily concerned about safety. So you make sure that there's no other aircraft. So, I mean, you have to recognize that. And the people that I know are doing it have 2 people out there. One of them are out there looking in our area for spray pilots, because you really don't have to worry about any other aircraft if you're flying low like that. But the spray pilots, you do. I'm presenting to the North Dakota Aerial Applicators Association in October, and they're very interested in collaborating with UAS. But that's what's happening. We see private individuals, we see companies doing it, and in the examples of where FAA has looked at these and actually tried to fine people, so far on every one, they've failed if it's gone to court. My recommendation to a farmer, or my recommendation to a agronomist, or to any private company that's doing this, just remember, you've got to be safe. Because if you hurt somebody, or if you run into an airplane, you're liable. And there's no question about that you are going to be found guilty in a court. And so if your farmer is worth $5 million, is it worth it? That's my recommendation. I would do it, but I'm just saying that you are wide open legally. That's my personal opinion. Going ahead. We use, this is a thermal camera. It gives a temperature for each pixel of the image. So if I held my arm out like this, I would imagine that this pixel would have a lower temperature than this pixel. A Sony RX100, it gives just regular JPEG images, and a Tetracam ADC. A Tetracam is a camera that gives near infrared. And for those of you who are familiar with this, a lot of work in agriculture has been done over the last 40 years with different kinds of imagery. And if you take red and near infrared, you can, red is absorbed by green chlorophyll, and near infrared is reflected. And you get a very accurate, and I'll show you some pictures of that, very accurate estimation of where you have more or less vegetation, you know, more higher crop yield potential, and different qualities. One of the issues that we had is that because we're in this test site, the University of North Dakota, our other university, has an aeronautical program. They're doing the flying for us. And they didn't put a GPS on their aircraft. So all these images, putting them together is a bigger issue. I have a few images, and I'll go through them quickly because I know that it's in this light area is not much value. But this just shows corn emergence. This one shows corn at about a three-leaf stage, and you can pick out individual ones, and I'll show you why of this. This is a cornfield taken about middle of the 20th, I think the 23rd, yeah, the 23rd of June. Again, these are plots. This is a wheat field on July 11th. Now, as I said to Boeing and Northrop Grumman and others, flying the aircraft is the easy part. How you handle the data is the big problem. We will fly an area the size of this area, this grounds here, inside the trees, and we would probably pick up 100 images. And those images then have to be put together into one image, a mosaic. This is the example of the images. When the folks fly them like they're doing today, when they go back to the University of North Dakota tonight, they'll upload those images for about a 1 square mile, and that's going to take them about an hour and a half on a university type line. So you have to upload that data, and then the students that I have working for me download that data tomorrow morning and do all this processing on it. You see all these individual images, and if you looked closer, you would see a lot of information about each one. Then we use a software called Agisoft, but there are a number of softwares out there to do this. And we would typically, at this point, it's a big problem. A farmer that I know I'm working with, he flew 13 quarters of land, and I realize you don't deal with quarter sections out here, but a quarter section is 160 acres. He flew 13 of those in one day and spent the next 2 days processing that. Big problem. We got to get past that. Trimble, by the way, has a way of getting past that, and I'll talk about that too when we get to the Trimble aircraft. This is what came from this, and again, this is the area that wanted. So these areas on the outside were extra. They didn't need that, but they flew some of it anyway. What I wanted to show here, and I'd be happy to visit about this, and again, not visible to you, but every one of these softwares that takes those individual images and stitches them together deteriorates the quality of the individual images a little bit. The best thing to do when you fly with unmanned aircraft is to get like 80% overlap. Because the software, if we took this picture of this podium and you had the aircraft fly, 15 feet over there and then over it and then over here, the software would look for this pixel in all three images. And if it found it, that's how it puts it together. So if it had it in 10 images, it would do a better job and distort it less. So that's kind of how it works. One of the first things that we did with it is to do a plant out. I asked a farmer, what's the first thing you would do if you had unmanned aircraft in terms of management in your farm? And he said, I plant my corn, and we already talked about this, I plant my corn at 32,000 seeds per acre in his part of North Dakota. He said, I want to get at least 30,000 to grow out of the ground and become corn plants and produce cobs of corn. But he said, I spend $80 an acre from the time the corn comes out of the ground until I pull my combine in to harvest it. So $80 an acre. This particular farmer, I think, has, you know, about 2,000 acres of corn. So he said, if I could fly my corn a few days after it comes out of the ground and have the computer count the seeds per acre, or plants per acre, and I found out that this little 2 acres or that little 5 acres, instead of having the 30,000 seeds, had 15,000 plants per acre or 10,000 plants per acre, I would manage that differently. He said, I would either go out, if things are right, I might replant corn into it, or he said, I might just spray it and put soybeans in it or some other crop. Or he said, I might just abandon it and just make sure the weeds are kept down. But the point is, a lot of money can be saved if you can manage just that quickly. I talked to another farmer who said, I will never farm again without an unmanned aircraft because that instant information is so valuable to me. And this is just one example. But we use the software called MATLAB, and you have to do a little bit of programming to do it, but we just took one little area, counted the plants, and on the left-hand side is what the researchers on the ground found, and what the right-hand side is what we found, and the numbers are almost identical. We don't have the statistical correlation, but that's the kind of information that we'll have on our summary at the end of the season. So planting, counting plants. This was one that I was really hoping would show up a little bit better. But on the left is a full-color image of some plots with different herbicide applications and different weed control. And you can't see anything on this side on a good image, I mean with different light, you can immediately pick out the difference. So a near-infrared vegetative index is very valuable. And you could do that as an agronomist. If you're out there contracting with farmers as an agronomist to walk farmers' fields, you could fly over that field first and say, oh, I really better walk that part because I see the problems there. So you could increase your efficiency of your business. This is an example of one of the farmers that I work with used near-infrared and red. It did a vegetative index, and the red color is less vegetation, the yellow is more, and the green is the highest. And right in the middle here is a nitrogen-rich strip, and interesting, Joe, it's very difficult to pick out the effect of that nitrogen-rich strip. He had doubled the rate, and I said, you know, my observation is, did that, you told the computer to do it, but did it really do it? Because I don't see a lot. But anyway, his purpose then is to compare, to do this for fertilization, in-season fertilization. If this is 100% of what your potential yield is, you'd make it your comparisons on your variable rate as you go across the field to that area. So a vegetative index across the field. I think that's probably the use that will work the best. By the way, a lot of people think, and think correctly, do we really need this kind of resolution to do in-season fertilization, side dressing of corn? That we, on our research, one of the objectives was to compare what we got from the air with unmanned aircraft to rapid eye satellite imagery. I don't know if any of you use satellite imagery, but rapid eye you have to pay for, and it has 5 meter resolution. So every pixel is 5 meters by 5 meters. We've tried to collect satellite imagery on this farm that we're doing. Every time the satellite flew over, which is about once a week, since the middle of May, there have been no images that were cloud-free. There have been no images. So we can't, I mean, it'd be nice to use satellite imagery, but it simply wasn't available. So that part of our research is failing because we can't do the comparison because there haven't been good images. Interesting, I think, observation about satellite imagery. What this shows is each one of these colors has an index from a -1 to a +1, an NDVI image of vegetation. And so then you could use this map. You'd have to zone it a little bit with another software to make nitrogen recommendations. This is a thermal image of cattle in a small little feedlot, half the size of this tent. And it was interesting. We were flying the rotorcopter over them, and they were very concerned, the people flying the aircraft for us, that they were going to, you know, scare the cattle. Well, it bothered them a little bit to begin with, but not enough to really move around. But they were looking up. They regularly looked up at the aircraft. After a while, they didn't look up at all. But anyway, each one of these pixels, and we have to zoom into it, has a different temperature. Different, and this is the looking at animals in heat. This is looking at different, an example of looking at different bedding types. Don't have the results, but again, that's some of the things that we're doing.
I might have to do this.
Not sure how this is going to show up, but I just want to demonstrate with a little bit of video the two different aircraft we're using. This is a Dragon Flyer. It's about 3 feet across, has four electric motors. All of them have electric motors that I've seen, although I see one out here that has a gasoline engine. And you'll notice as it's flying that it's moving around like this, but the gimbal on it keeps that camera perfectly straight. So it works very, very well. There's a couple of electric motors on there that sense position and change it and keep it constant. This is one that was flown in May in North Dakota. You see that the leaves hadn't come on the trees yet. This aircraft does not have an autopilot in it, which means that somebody's got to be operating that all the time. It's a big issue. There is kind of a fun factor associated with this, that's for sure. That one. This is one of the training that I did with some other people with Trimble. And Trimble's aircraft is a lot more advanced. Now, there's others like that. It comes with a ruggedized tablet computer. That tablet computer sells for $4,000. Okay? It comes with the cameras. It comes with filters so you can filter out like the blue light to get a red and green and near infrared. In addition to that, it comes with this launcher. It has to be launched. It's electric. This one flies for about an hour with one battery. And this is the hokey part of it. You have to, it launches. It launches with bungee cords. So you wind that up because the that's why you pay the $50,000, okay? here's the bungee cords. And put the aircraft on. And you can't see it here. I hopefully see it on a different one. It has electric motors. An electric motor that doesn't turn on until it's about 20 feet off the launcher, so you don't break the propellers and they're pointed back. Now, in addition to this, I want to stop that for a minute. Because, as I told you, that you come with it with a tablet computer. The first thing you do to make this thing operate, it's completely autonomous. So you connect your computer to the internet, and you download a Google Earth image, like of this area here. You download a Google Earth image of your field, and then you go out to the field, and you set up your launcher, and you take your computer, which has a GPS in it and a radio in it, as does the aircraft. You walk over to where the launcher is, and you touch the screen, and that says launch. And that arrow, that launch little point on your screen then, of course, you have the field, you can see the trees, and like in this case, you'd see everything, you'd see the tent, and not the tent on Google Earth, because it wouldn't have been here when they flew it. But you touch that, and then there's a little arrow on that dot, so you point the launcher into the wind. Then you walk to where you want it to land, and this thing needs about 75 to 100 meters to land safely. It would be very difficult to land it in here. I would not probably land it in here. So you walk to where you want it to land, and you touch it, and you say land. And again, a little arrow on it, so you point it into the wind. Then you outline the area of your field. Let's just, as a simple thing, say that it's a rectangle, a quarter section of land. You touch the four points, and it puts a boundary around it. And then you say, what kind of resolution do you want on your picture? Say you want 1 meter, that determines how high it has to fly. Or you say you want 1 centimeter, that determines how low it has to fly. At that point, you take the computer, or first you take the aircraft and put it on, and in this case he's checking the pitot tube because that measures airspeed and air pressure. So he checks it to make sure that works, and there's a little beep. You arm the aircraft. So everything you collected in your hands, in your tablet, you send then to the aircraft. Then, at that point, you launch it, and then you go have a cup of coffee. Because what it does is the computer flies it back and forth, and if you wanted to have certain pixel size that knew how to fly, it flies to the end of the field, shuts off the camera, makes a big turn, comes back, turns on the camera, goes back and forth, and when it's done, it comes back to where you told it to land, and it circles until you hit a button on your screen that says confirm, and then it comes in to land, and I'll show you that too. But it's that simple, and that's where we need to be going. I know there are folks here in the room who are selling these aircraft. That's my opinion. Doesn't have to be quite that simple, but it needs to be so that the operator, that a computer can fly it. A computer is going to do a better job. And then the other thing that you can do with this aircraft with Trimble's is you can say, come here anytime, because you see an airplane over there or a flock of geese gets up. So wherever you're standing, because there's a radio in it and a GPS, it'll come to you and circle over you. Or you can say, go up or go down so many feet or meters. And you can say, you can touch a point on your screen and say, go there, and it'll go there and circle. Or if everything else gets really bad, you can say, flight termination. And it will immediately turn off the motor and come down, and you have to go find it. Now it would be nice if we had the sound on this, because it's kind of a whirring sound, like a small electric motor, almost like an old, I don't know, small vacuum cleaner or something. But it takes off, and this one flies fast, about 50 miles an hour, and as you can see, you quickly lose it. It'll come back in sight in a second, maybe here. Oh, this, you can't see this very well. I was proud of this. I took two pictures right when it was taking off, and I got it when it was halfway up. There's another one. And then it goes on to continue flying. And so in this case, the person on the right is holding the ground control station, and there you see a little bit of a dot in the middle. That's at 250 meters, so 700-800 feet above the ground. And there you can see it flying, and now what it will do is it'll come to that area where it's supposed to land, and it'll circle. In fact, that's exactly what it's doing. It's circling until it gets down to 75 meters, and it's waiting for a command from the control station to land, because it won't come down until you give it that. Now he's confirming that, and eventually you'll see it come on the right-hand side to come down. This is my, can't see that either, but it hit the ground, came back up about 5 feet, and went back down again. Now this aircraft, the motor turns off when it senses that it's 15 meters off the ground. Then the motor turns off, and then it just glides in. Now that means if you're flying it at different elevations, you have to tell the computer what the elevation is, difference between where you launch and where you land. And so one of these fellows, in fact, the guy walking on the left, broke the propellers on one on landing, because He launched it at one elevation, and then he landed it at about 3 or 4 meters lower down the hill. And he had to estimate how much it was. He estimated it to be 15 meters difference. And so when it came down and got, you know, close to the ground, it assumed it had another 15 meters. In reality, it was on the ground or close to it. So the motor was still running. A lot of different things like that. Now, kind of in summary, considerations. First of all, if you're going to do this in agriculture, and I assume in any other business, make sure that your aircraft has a GPS on it and can be flown with autopilot, so that you can mark the areas that you want it to fly. Maybe it's just the latitude and longitude where you want the pictures, and then it'll take off, come back, and land on its own. That's really important. A fixed wing or a rotocopter. The fixed wing that we're flying, I've personally flown it in 30 miles an hour, gotten excellent imagery from it. The rotocopter that we're flying on our, that Dragonflyer, if it gets above 15 miles an hour, they have to shut down because it just can't handle a wind stronger than that. If you're going to take a large area of fields, I talked to one farmer that I work with, as I said, flew about 2,000 acres in one day, and that took him about 8 hours of time. He could have done, this Trimble that we're flying will fly about 600, well, a section of land a mile by a mile in 1 hour and give you 2 centimeter resolution, so very high resolution in 1 hour. So you could do a commercial fields very easily on that. If you want to get real-time feedback, the rotocopter is better, so you can get that real-time imagery and see what that part of the field looks like, or see how many cattle are out there, or see if there's a, you know, animal that's not moving. Durability is important, and of course, cost is important. I think that in order to get started on this, to do any kind of management on your farm, that you're going to have to probably look at spending $1,500 to start with, maybe $2,000. We have one that we built for $1,000 with a camera and autopilot, but we're using a laptop computer of our own to fly it. The rotocopters, most of them, can only fly about 15 minutes, 12 to 15 minutes on a battery. But you can recharge the battery quickly, so you have an inverter in your pickup or car and you recharge, and we bought just extra batteries. The fixed wing generally fly from 45 minutes to hour and a half or hour and 15 minutes. The sensors and the camera, lots of uses for video and still images. Primarily, I see the use for still images, but video certainly has lots of capable uses. You need to make sure that you're capturing a GPS latitude and longitude for each image, and you do that with that GPS on board. And then the near-infrared imagery in crop production, you need to get a camera that can take the near-infrared to get that vegetative index. Some of the issues. The biggest issue that we have to deal with is the quantity of data. And we have to do that automatically. I forgot to mention in that Trimble aircraft, you get a $15,000, they retail it for $15,000, I don't know what it's worth, software that comes with it that will automatically stitch that imagery together for you. And it's you know, if you fly, say, 1 foot resolution, you could fly 100 acres of land and it would stitch it together in 5 minutes. So that would take care of that. And if you have to transfer imagery, you're going to have to be able to have some kind of a relatively fast line to do that. Software, a lot of different softwares. I think we need research on that, and we need lots of assistance for different kinds of software. The image degradation by the software is very important, so you have to have a lot of overlap. And then image georeferencing, that's an easy part because there's a lot of softwares out to do that. And finally, the most important thing that you're interested in is how do you take that imagery and get information that you can make management decisions on your farm and be profitable with it. That's really the key, so we're still working on that. If you want see the research results, just go to NDSU. Ag Machinery, and that's my website. You'd have to then click on Unmanned Aircraft. There's a lot of other topics there as well. Jenny, did I go over?
Good.
Okay.
Questions.
Repeat the questions. I will. And I'm very much interested in, I didn't ask, and I usually do, how many of you are using unmanned aircraft now? No hands going up. One. Okay. We do a precision ag summit similar to this in the winter time, and we usually have 300 or 400 people. This last year we had 200 growers, 200 farmers in the audience, and we asked how many were using UAS in 2014 in their crop, and 15% of the respondents said they are using them, and it was about three times that much that planned to use them in the growing season next year. So it's a tool that's going to be used. Questions? Yes. If you purchase them, what are the requirements for insurance? I was dealing with that on early Monday, and the company that we're working with is a company out of Mankato, Minnesota. I don't remember the name of the company, but they were going to charge us or are going to charge us $1,200 for $1 million of liability per year. I mean, $1,200 per year, which I didn't think was too bad, and I think it went up to about $1,500 or $1,600 for $2 million. And the reason I did that is because when our university gets the COA, the certificate, we have to have that liability because the state of North Dakota covers me for $1 million when I'm working. So if I hurt somebody or ran a tractor into somebody, but unfortunately that state of North Dakota liability doesn't cover the unmanned aircraft, so we have to purchase it our own. So, and that doesn't cover, it was about another... about 10% of the value of the aircraft, they wanted to insure the aircraft, and they wanted to have a $500 deductible. Other questions? Yes?
How accurate is your GPS? Are you putting markers on the ground so you know exactly the locations?
Yeah, how accurate is the GPS? We are only using WAS correction, so it's only accurate to a meter or less. And we're putting markers on the ground, but on our case, we know the marker, we know the boundaries of the plots with latitude accurately. So we've got that to reference with. Trimble recommends that you put markers out there that you know where they are. Good point.
We got plenty of time for questions. And I mean, this is the opportunity for somebody to real.
I think, yes. For crop watering, and we would use thermal imagery to get, and the best that we've come with so far is to measure the temperature of the part of the crop that's heat stressed or water stressed. It has a different canopy temperature. So, and the software we're using, the name escapes me, but it's with the FLIR, F-L-I-R camera. But basically looking at different canopy temperatures. Now we trying to measure moisture in the soil. I don't know of a way to do that. Maybe somebody else does from the air. Anybody know? But it's just thermal.
What about insects?
Yeah, insects. We're using for all of these. We're collecting. The Tetracam camera collects near infrared and red, so we get that vegetative index. And so we're looking when the researchers find the insect damage on the plant, we're looking at both full color image. Can we pick it out with a regular color image? And if you're talking about this imagery that we're using has about 1 centimeter resolution, quarter of an inch. So we're being able to pick up areas on a corn or a soybean leaf that have been damaged. The near infrared looks just at the reflection of the to get a vegetative index, the differences across the field. So in that case, we're using the near infrared. The video, we haven't used any of that really yet. And I don't see I see the reason for that is being able to look at the field, but. Yes?
Just going to
you're looking at in livestock?
Other areas that we're looking at in livestock. One of the things that they want us to look at, and I'm not sure how to do it yet, is to look at what he called rogue animals. Animals that cause problems in the herd and wanted to fly them at like hourly throughout the day to see which animals are causing the problem, which ones do the fighting, which ones go through the fences, and be able to pick those up. And again, we haven't gotten to that yet. I think in our area, ranchers are very concerned about oil development in western North Dakota because the roads get a lot of dust, and you can see that as the season goes on, the grass in the pastures is taller closer to the gravel roads and shorter away from the gravel roads. So the farmers are saying the cows don't like that grass with all the dust on it, and they're trying to get a look at that. The same is true with yield, and we're doing a study on yield. This is not on this project, but different, looking at the impact of dust on wheat. Does it affect yield? Dust from the roads, so that's another one. I think the most important thing on livestock would be to count them on a regular basis. I've challenged our engineering students, have to, as in many places, they have to have a senior project. And I'm going to get three of them to design an unmanned aircraft for me, a rotorcopter type that's charged solar. So it can be put out on the edge of a pasture or edge of a field in a little storage area. And the storage area is covered with solar panels so that when I want to sit down at my computer 20 miles away, I can outline a little area on that field within a distance of that. Tell the computer to tell that aircraft to go fly that, send images back to me, go back and land there and recharge for the next day. So I think counting your animals and checking your animals that way, at this point that's not a legal thing to do, but that's, I see a potential use there. Yes? Yeah, pesticide application, two things come to mind. First of all, half of the rice acres in Japan this year are applied with autonomous aircraft. Pesticide application. Half of the acres are applied. Yamaha makes the aircraft. It's 10 or 12 feet long. It carries about 50 gallons of liquid. And you just tell where the field is. It goes there, applies the pesticide, comes back home. And the reason for that is that they're farming on areas that are difficult to get to with machines. So it's on the side of a mountain. Secondly, when I was in Sacramento last week, that was a different 2 hours difference than North Dakota, but I got a call at 6 a.m. from a farmer, and I told him where I was, and he apologized for calling me at that time, but he had a canola field that showed damage in the middle of the field. And he said, can you come and fly that field for you? I saw your presentation at one of the field days last week. And, I lined up a farmer to fly it. But the point is, he could see damage on that, and he wanted to be able to pick out herbicide drift. It turned out what he did was interesting with precision technology. The first thing he did is he thought, maybe I switched varieties on that field. That difference I'm seeing is where I switched. So he replayed his planting, his as-applied map. He replayed it on his computer. He said, no, where I switched varieties is not that place. So then he said, I sprayed that myself. And he said, after the first tank full, then I filled the tank again and sprayed the rest of the field. And he said, maybe I had a contaminant in my first spray tank. So he wanted to see. So he replayed his as-applied map, and that didn't line up with it. So then he used aircraft and picked up that it was really a spray drift coming from the next field. And it was, a temperature inversion that caused it. But anyway, he used that. I know that there are federal crop insurance companies or crop insurance companies that are using unmanned aircraft in North Dakota to do evaluation of damage from hail damage. Easy way to do it. Another interesting thing, we have a grower co-op, a sugar co-op in North Dakota called American Crystal Sugar, North Dakota, Minnesota. And it's a grower-owned co-op. In order to sell sugar beets, you have to have one share in the company for every acre of sugar beets. And the shares sell for about $2,000 each. So if you have 1,000 acres of sugar beets, you know, you're spending $2 million before you can do anything. But interestingly, as I said, you have to have one share for every acre. So if you have 100 shares, you'd plant 100 acres. The farmers are cheating on each other, planting 105 acres, 107 acres. Isn't that interesting? Grower co-op. So they came to us and said, can we do a research project to measure those fields? And we can do that very easily, to measure very accurately. I don't know if that's admirable or not, but any other questions or comments? Thoughts? I think as I look to the future, next year and the year after, I think two things will happen. First of all, I think companies are going to pick up a little bit larger aircraft, and they're going to fly all of Maryland every Monday morning. And they're going to put that in the cloud, and then they're going to sell it to you based on the common land units on, you know, every time you want to download something, it'll be $3 an acre or something. I think that's one business model that'll work. I think another one is, I think the first people that'll adapt it are agronomists because they can increase the efficiency. I think individual farmers will use it too if we can get this data management under control. If the point is that you can't be, I know from working in precision ag over the last, you know, 25 years that farmers don't use satellite imagery because there's too much work involved in getting that imagery down to the tractor. So many of them don't use it. And technology, I can remember in 1995, I asked what kind of technology in GPSs or precision ag is going to catch on first. And my thought was yield monitors, because you can learn so much from it. Farmers have had the yield monitors in North Dakota for 25 years, and they're not using the data. But right away, they started using light bars, and then more advanced auto guidance, and then auto steer. And why? Because you can do in your head, if you had 8% overlap before or 10% overlap, you can quickly do in your head what the profit is by spending $10,000 to get auto steer or something. So this is a little more difficult. All right.